Here's my take. The massive protests we've been watching in Hong Kong highlight something we often tend to forget, the fragility of the Chinese political system. China's rise has been something of a miracle. It is quite simply the most successful case of economic development in human history. The country's GDP has grown around 10% a year for 40 years, moving more than 850 million people out of poverty. In doing so, China has also proved to be the greatest exception to a near iron law of politics. Decades of political science research have shown that there is a fairly strong connection between economic growth and democracy. As countries modernize their economies, typically they're also forced to change their societies and eventually their political systems to make them more open, accountable, and democratic. Now, there are outliers, such as oil-rich countries, which gain their wealth without any need to modernize. But China is the real outlier. China got richer but stayed resolutely non-democratic. In fact, in recent years, the political system has become more repressive, censorship has increased, and the president has dispensed with term limits for himself. What explains China's almost unique path to wealth without democracy? Yuan Yuing Ang argues in Foreign Affairs that over the last few decades, China has actually been developing an autocracy with democratic characteristics. She notes that reforms have made the country's vast administrative bureaucracy, once a stagnant communist behemoth, more nimble, transparent, and accountable. These changes should be considered a type of political reform, she argues. Ang and others point to China's highly meritocratic political system, where officials move up through rigorous exams, evaluations, and objective measures of results like economic growth. This exceedingly competitive system ensures quality and responsiveness, its defenders say. Scholars like Daniel Bell argue that such a political model rests on the trust and faith in a Mandarin governing class that is a key feature of Confucian societies. And yet, one has to wonder, good bureaucracy is not the same thing as democracy, which centers on the ability to both choose your leaders and throw them out of power. As for Confucian societies, whenever we hear cultural arguments, let's not forget Hong Kong and Taiwan. Both are thoroughly Chinese societies with a deep demonstrated desire for democracy. The United States is now quarreling with China on several fronts. In these struggles, Americans often make the mistake of thinking that their adversary is 10 feet tall. First, it's not clear that China is an adversary, certainly not in the Cold War sense, but rather a competitor. More important, while China has great strengths, it also has weaknesses. Consider President Xi Jinping's situation. Growth in China has slowed substantially. It is being bolstered because local governments and state-owned companies are borrowing vast sums of money. The country confronts a future with fewer workers, the consequence of its one-child policy, itself a classic example of the dangers of a dictatorship and planned economy. But perhaps above all, China has a political system that faces real pressure. In a global age of populism and anti-elitism, China is still ruled by a cadre of distant elites. The Communist Party of China maintains power through the promise of growth and the application of force. It uses an elaborate system of censorship and increasingly sophisticated espionage on its own people. It faces a population that is not genetically or culturally different from those in Taiwan and Hong Kong, where millions are making clear they don't want just good government or clever bureaucrats, but democracy. So the trade war with America might turn out to be one of Xi's smaller problems.